Good videos, smooth taste.
It's just apple juice.
Amazing effects with no bitter aftertaste and professional quality. That's the retro renaissance difference.
Shout out.
Son of a, will somebody give me a towel? Afternoon, everybody, and thanks for joining our group of friends. My name is Kevin, and you are welcome here. Whether in their real life or simply the roles they played in the movies, there are many iconic women who were a powerful force in the 1980s. So today, let's remember seven badass women in the 1980s.
People. And if I have played badass women, it's because I think women are pretty badass. And that there are many moments in life where each of us has to find the badass in herself and, you know, kind of take care of business.
Sigourney Weaver was born Susan Alexandra Weaver on October 8, 1949. If there was only one reason for her to be on our list as a badass, it would be this scene.
From her, you bitch!
I mean, how good is that scene? There was huge applause at that moment in the theater. Also very well known for her role in the Ghostbusters franchise and a businesswoman and working girl. Sigourney says she lacked confidence in her looks as a child because, in her words, she was taller than most girls, and she was told by her mom that at the age of 8 that she was simply plain looking. She states that she thought, if my mother doesn't think I'm pretty, no one else will. At age 13, Weaver was sent to see a psychiatrist to address what her parents perceived to be their daughter's uncommunicative personality. She says, I never even spoke to the psychiatrist. I was a normal teenager, and teenagers hate telling their parents anything. Sigourney then attended Stanford University. It was there that she realized her dream was to become an actress. After graduating from Stanford with a Bachelor of Arts degree in literature in 1971, Weaver moved back to the East, to Connecticut, to attend Yale Drama School. She finished the program in 1974, 1 year before another actress and new friend, Meryl Streep. Sigourney says it best when she says,
you broke the ship. You broke the bloody ship.
Computer, is there a replacement beryllium sphere on board?
Computer, is there a replacement beryllium sphere on board?
Negative. No reserve beryllium sphere exists on board.
No, we have no extra beryllium sphere on board.
You know, that is really getting annoying.
Look, I have one job on this lousy ship. It's stupid, but I'm gonna do it, okay?
Sure, no problem.
I also have a big interest in how people react to actors on the street and how they identify with the characters.
Yeah.
Now, after the first Terminator film, did you find that you'd meet men and they'd have some kind of instinct to protect you? Or how did men react to you
in
the street?
No, nobody wants to protect me.
Yeah.
I think I look like I can handle my own. Nobody, people did respond to the character. And everyone thought they were being very clever by saying, oh, you sell Connell. You know, every single man in the world thought that this was their own line. No one had ever said it to me. It's very funny.
Linda Hamilton has always been a strong voice for women, even continuing in 2018, when she reprised her Sarah Connor role. Former spouse James Cameron stated, as meaningful as she was to gender and action stars everywhere back then, it's going to make a huge statement to have that seasoned warrior that she's become return. There are 50-year-old and 60-year-old guys out there still killing bad guys, but there isn't an example of that for women. Well, there is now. And when she reprised her role, she still looked like a badass. Although Linda Hamilton is best known for her performance as Sarah Connor in the Terminator series and its sequel Terminator 2 Judgment Day and Dark Fate, she is also known for playing the character of Catherine Chandler in the television series Beauty and the Beast. She admitted to having suffered from bipolar disorder and brought awareness and light to those that may have felt alone battling their own mental illness. She once said she became sort of an icon for fitness and toughness, and she thought, no, that is not what I want to be portrayed as. When discussing her tough image in Hollywood, she goes on to say she was a woman in hell, a woman that was suffering horribly. Please don't mistake who I am for who that character is. I think not playing a part in her real life just makes her more of a badass. Continuing to be outspoken and owning who she has also stated that she has been celibate for 15 years and that she loves her alone time. In an interview, she also recalled once that she heard someone whispering as she was on stage and playing pool. They whispered, "That can't be her. She'd shoot pool a lot better than that." Recalling the story, Hamilton let loose with her throaty laugh. "I'm not Sarah Connor who can do everything brilliantly," she said. "It has kept me very real because I tend to swing the other way when people assign that to me."
I called Linda. She didn't want to be the little waitress that she played the first time. She said, "I want to be crazy."
"Good morning, Dr. Silberman."
"You don't have an appointment, do you?"
"Well, we didn't know how to make one."
"Appointment for what?"
"What do you want?"
"We need some help."
"Ha! Already? You just bit the big one 2 months ago and you want help."
"2 months? What does that have to do with anything?"
"You're going to use up all your health vouchers. D-90s. You spend 125 years on Earth, actually in that house, during which you get only 3 Class 1 D-90 intercessions with Juno. You probably haven't even read through the manual completely yet. You'll have to wait if you don't have an appointment."
"An appointment with who?"
"For Juno, your caseworker. Number 54,601, Ferndock."
Geena Davis. Geena Davis was born Virginia Elizabeth Davis on January 21st, 1956 in Wareham, Massachusetts. An American actress who was skilled at comedic roles and brought charm and likability to eccentric characters. Now, not longer after I talked about Bill Murray in this video here, I would read about how he is not such a nice guy and may be problematic. One of the people coming out about Bill Murray would be Geena Davis, who worked on the highly underrated film Quick Change. She recounts a moment where Bill insisted she offer him a back massage in her new book, Dying of Politeness. Well, here's Geena telling it in her own words.
"In this industry, right? But I have to ask you about this one particular thing that's getting some attention from the book. You write about alleged sort of abusive behavior on the part of Bill Murray, your co-star in the 1989 film Quick Change. You say he used a massager on you during a private meeting, or tried to and got to for a little bit, and another time berated you in front of the cast and crew, yet you never said anything about it at the time. You said those were ways to test you."
"Well, I only learned later what it was about. It was at the audition that before he would let me audition or talk about the role or anything, I had to let him put this massager on. I had to lay down on a bed in the hotel suite and let him put this massager on my back. And he was so insistent about it that I knew I was never going to be able to leave the room unless I went crazy, without being forced to do this thing. And I found out later that it was because he I had just won an Oscar, and he thought, I'm not going to cast her unless I know she's not going to think she's all that. And I have to be sure that she's going to do what I want. And So that was one test. And then when I got the role, the first day of shooting, he went crazy and screamed at me in front of hundreds of people. That was also, I saw him do that subsequently to other people. And I realized that's his way of intimidating people and making them, you know, afraid of him. And then they won't challenge him, I guess, is the idea.
So although many of her roles may not be considered action hero roles, unless you count Cutthroat Island, which I thought was fun but was notoriously panned, in her real life she is very much a badass. For example, Geena Davis is a feminist hero and outspoken activist. She has been a supporter of such causes as representation of women in children's films and diversity in the entertainment industry. Also, she was almost an Olympic archer. Davis is the founder of the Geena Davis Institute on Gender and Media, which has conducted extensive research and representation in movies, alongside educating creators on disparities and how to fix them, and advocating for a change. We often hear about feminism and the lack thereof in movies targeted at adults, but Davis has frequently focused on the representation of girls in children's media. A study conducted by the Institute has revealed disparities both in the number of male and female speaking characters in children's movies and the types of roles they are given. And she has spoken out about how important it is for children to grow up with images of fair representation. She also started a film festival, the Bentonville Film Festival, which started in 2015. It is dedicated to providing a voice for women and minorities, and it guarantees that the winners of the festival will receive commercial distribution. The films entered are required to have one woman or minority behind the scenes, leaders and crew members, in addition to at least half of the cast, either female or other minorities. Also, in 2002, Geena Davis created a program called Geena Davis Takes Aim that focused on getting more girls into athletics. Davis herself discovered sports at age 41, and she wanted to help more young women get into athletics at a younger age. She has been noted in saying that while some people may see one successful feminist film meaning the tides have changed, Davis has often been the voice that insists that we haven't won until there's gender equality in every facet of the entertainment industry. After Jennifer Lawrence penned an essay about her own struggles with sexism, Geena Davis wrote an essay for the Daily Beast criticizing those who are overly optimistic about this moment in culture. She says being that voice isn't always easy, but it's an important perspective for a celebrity to take. When speaking to Vanity Fair, Geena Davis mentioned a very easy way for more women to be in films. When she meets with producers and executives about starring in movies, she suggests that they look at the movies they are already going to make, that they have planned, out and slated, and change some of those first names in the script to female names. Just with the stroke of a pen, you've now created probably very unique, unstereotyped female characters. That's not to say that none of her acting roles have not been badass roles. Take a look at Thelma and Louise or A League of Their Own, or her role as Dr. Nicole Herman on Grey's Anatomy. Geena Davis has been tireless in her efforts to promote women and diversity, especially in her own industry.
Yeah.
Female actresses, I think Ellen Burstyn is very good also. I love Ellen Burstyn. Katharine Hepburn, you know, when you're young, Katharine Hepburn.
What qualities do you see in them that really turns you on?
I suppose the greatest quality for a woman actress would be a kind of intelligence and a strength that comes out. Sometimes it's sort of loony, you know, like Vanessa Redgrave.
She gets kind of strange in these big eyes, but you know that she's a very bright, intelligent woman. In a man, I think it's a sort of vulnerability that's probably the most, the biggest factor. When you look at the biggest actors today, that's what they all kind of have, is that way of saying, I can be heard and I'm sensitive.
Jodie Foster's career spans long before the 1980s. Jodie Foster started her career at the age of 2. For 4 years, she made commercials and finally gave her debut as an actress in the TV series Mayberry RFD in 1968. She was born in Los Angeles on November 19, 1963, as Alicia Christian Foster, with classic films such as Freaky Friday.
But now...
We've switched bodies?
Not this one.
Lewis.
What are you?
It's me, Mom.
You're not my mother?
Yes. No, not this one. This one.
Wait a minute. That's not my voice. That's Mom's voice.
Hey, what's the matter with you?
Good grief, what am I doing here?
That's not my voice, that's Annabelle's voice.
Are you okay, Annabelle?
However, she would play a fighter as a victim of sexual assault in The Accused in 1988, and later into the 90s with Clarice Darling in Silence of the Lambs in 1991.
Robe. A well-scrubbed, hustling robe with a little taste. Good nutrition's given you some length of bone, but you're not more than one generation from poor wire trash, are you, Agent Starling? And that accent you've tried so desperately to shed, pure West Virginia. Where's your father, dear? Is he a coal miner? Does he stink of the land? And oh, how quickly the boys found you. All those tedious, sticky fumblings in the backseats of cars, while you could only dream of getting out, getting anywhere, getting all the way to the FBI.
You see a lot, Doctor. But are you strong enough to point that high-powered perception at yourself? What about it? Why don't you look at yourself and write down what you see? Maybe you're afraid to.
In her personal life, she would make no apologies for who she is and what she believes. Whether you agree or not, there's no doubting it takes a true badass to be your authentic self. She's also a successful director with films like Little Man Tate and Home for the Holidays. And when she got injured and hurt her knee and had to use a cane, she did not choose a plain old cane. She went a more badass way. Audiences have watched her play brave, relentless women fighting to save their daughters in films like Panic Room and Flight Plan. And one true life event would see Jamie Lee Curtis in a serious car accident in Venice, California, when Jamie Lee Curtis was the passenger of a black Yukon SUV that crashed into a BMW. As police and medical personnel flocked to the area, Jamie Lee Curtis's close friend, Jodie Foster, also arrived on the scene to rush to the aid of her injured friend.
Ms. Tobias, can you in any way prove to us that someone in that room, anyone, saw you struggling or heard you say no? No more questions.
Ms. Tobias, while you were being gang-raped on that pinball machine, what were you thinking?
Thinking?
Yes, what were you thinking? What words came into your head? Three men were repeatedly raping you, holding you down, and raping you, and their friends cheered and clapped, and you lay there naked and defenseless, struggling, weeping every part of your pain. What words came into your head? What words?
No.
No further questions, Your Honor.
Your mother was married to...
To my father.
To your father.
My,
Hey, these days, you know, that's
never
something.
Know. My father was a man named Eddie Fisher, and they were best friends with Elizabeth Taylor and her husband at the time, Mike Todd. Mike Todd tragically passed
died.
Away in a plane accident, and my father consoled Elizabeth with his penis.
Carrie Fisher. Carrie Fisher was born on October 21st, 1956, In the 1980s, it was very easy to get pigeonholed into a role that you played on screen, and much harder to break free from that role. Think Christopher Reeve, who could never quite shake the Superman persona. There's no doubt things have changed, and you see actors going from character to character, or from movies to TV, and it's great. However, some roles do define an actor, and that would be the case with Carrie Fisher as Princess Leia.
Governor Tarkin, I should have expected to find you holding Vader's leash.
I recognized your foul stench when I was brought on board.
When you've gotten past the energy shield, proceed directly to the rendezvous point. Understood?
Yeah.
Good luck.
Okay, everybody to your stations, let's go!
Right. Your Highness, we must take this last transport. It's our only hope.
Send all troops from Sector 12 to the South Pole to protect the fighter.
Leia! Go!
I don't know who you are or where you came from, but from now on, you do as I tell you, okay?
What the hell are you doing?
Somebody has to save our skins. Into the garbage chute, flyboy!
There is no doubt Carrie as Princess Leia was a space-fighting, Rebel Alliance princess and a warrior. However, in real life, that would be even more true. Another outspoken star who suffered from mental illness. It was common to try to keep those things private as a celebrity. Carrie would have none of that when she gave candid, honest advice about living with mental illness. She once said, "We have been given a challenging illness, and there is no other option than to meet those challenges. An opportunity to be a good example to others who might share our disorder. That's why it's important to find a community, however small, of other bipolar people to share experiences and find comfort in the similarities." Carrie Fisher also had a knack of responding with wit and humor while still making a point. For example, when George Lucas said she could not wear a bra in Star Wars, she recounts that George Lucas comes up to her on the first day of filming, and he takes one look at the dress and says, "You can't wear a bra under that dress." Carrie Fisher responds, "Okay, I'll bite. Why?" And George Lucas says, and I quote, "Because there's no underwear in space. What happens is you go to space and you become weightless. So far, so good, right? But then your body expands, but your bra doesn't. So you get strangled by your own bra." After reflecting on that moment, Carrie Fisher says that now she tells her younger friends that no matter how she goes, "I want it reported that I drowned in moonlight, strangled by my own bra." Carrie Fisher would go on to have future roles breaking out of the Princess Leia trap, such as The Burbs or When Harry Met Sally. And in 2015, there were many debates on how her body held up when she returned to the Star Wars universe. And she would say this, "Jim, please stop debating on whether or not I aged well. Unfortunately, it hurts all three of my feelings. My body hasn't aged well, as I have. Blow us." Although we lost Carrie Fisher, there is no doubt she is in the afterlife doing what she does best, not caring what people think, which is a rarity in show business.
Yours.
Hello.
I'm sorry to call so early.
Are you all right?
No one I know would call at this hour.
I did something terrible.
What did you do?
No one I know would call at this
That's
hour.
It's so awful.
I need to talk.
What happened?
What's the matter?
Harry came over last night.
I went over to Sally's last night.
Because I was upset that Joe was getting married.
And one thing led to another.
And before I knew it, we were kissing.
To make
and
a
then
long story short,
we did it.
They did it.
That's great, Sally.
We've been praying for it.
We should have done it in the first place.
For months we've been saying you should do it.
You guys belong together.
It's like killing two birds with one stone.
It's like two wrongs make a right. How was it?
The during part was good.
I thought it was good.
But then I felt suffocated.
Then I guess it wasn't.
Jesus, I'm sorry.
The worst.
I had to get out of there.
He just disappeared.
I feel so bad.
I'm so embarrassed.
I don't blame you.
That's horrible.
I think I'm coming down with something.
I think I'm catching a cold.
Look, it would have been great if it worked out, but it didn't.
Mm. I should never go to bed with anyone when you found out your last boyfriend is getting married.
Who's that talking?
Who?
Is that Jess on the phone?
It's Jane Fonda on the VCR.
It's Brian Gumbel.
You want to come over for breakfast?
No, I'm not up to it.
No, I feel too awful.
Good. I mean, it's so early.
But call me later if you want.
I'll call you later, okay?
Okay, bye.
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 Bye. God.
I know.
Tell me I'll never have to be out there again.
You will never have to be out there again.
I came to live with my grandmother because I was a child born out of wedlock, and my mother moved to the North. She's a part of that great migration to the North in the late 50s. And I was left with my grandmother, like so many other black youngsters were, left to be taken care of by their grandmothers and grandfathers and aunts and uncles. And I was one of those children. It actually probably saved my life. It is the reason why I am where I am today, because my grandmother gave me the foundation for success that I was allowed to continue to build upon. My grandmother taught me to read, and that opened the door to all kinds of possibilities for me. And had I not been with my grandmother and been with my mother struggling in the North, you know, moving from apartment to apartment, I probably would not have had the foundation that I had. So I was allowed.
Oprah Winfrey. In 1976, Winfrey moved to Baltimore, Maryland, where she hosted the TV chat show People Are Talking. The show became a hit, and Winfrey stayed with it for 8 years, after which she was recruited by a Chicago TV station to host her own morning show called AM Chicago. Oprah Winfrey was born in Kosciuszko, Mississippi on January 29, 1954, after a troubled adolescence in a small farming community where she was sexually abused by a number of male relatives and friends of her mother. Winfrey moved to Nashville to live with her father, Vernon, a barber and a businessman. Although best known for her talk show, which ran from 1986 to 2011, there is no doubting her performance in The Color Purple was amazing.
Oh, look at that. That's the cutest little face I ever saw. Can you give me some sugar? Well,
Miss Millie always going on over the cup.
You children are so clean. Would you like to work for me? Be my maid?
Hell no.
What did you say?
Hell no.
What did she say?
Hey, can't you pump that crude a little faster?
Gail, what did you say to Miss Millie?
I said, hell.
No, Miss Sophia.
No, Miss Sophia, no!
And Oprah took her success and gave back.
Everybody in the audience, now listen to me carefully, is being given a special package, and I don't want you to open it. Do not open it. Cameras are on you, so do not open until I tell you. All right, open your boxes. Open your boxes. 1, 2, 3.
Okay, aside from giving out cars and other gifts, Oprah has become the first black female billionaire, a magazine publisher, a recipient of the Presidential Medal of Freedom. She started a leadership academy for girls in South Africa, and of course, Oprah's book club. She took her fame and used it to inspire and encourage, and was open about her struggles losing weight and her past.
Well, then you're all set.
My gift is my command. Stay together. Don't let anyone separate you.
I went up to the top of the Gulf and Western building, the 33rd floor, and he had this amazing office that looked all over Manhattan, and he was back there. And I walked in, and his son was sitting there, very excited that he'd brought in this new actress. And the father said to his son, in Italian, because I understand Italian, he said, "Che brutta." You know, why do you bring me this ugly thing?
Whoa.
Yeah. Very sobering. Oh. You know, as a young girl. So I said to him, "Mi dispiace molto, ma," you know, "but I understand what you're saying. I'm sorry I'm not beautiful enough to be in King Kong."
Meryl Streep was born June 22, 1949. Streep started voice training at age 12 and took up acting in high school in 1971. She graduated from Vassar College in Poughkeepsie, New York, with a degree in drama and costume design. After working in summer stock theater, Streep studied drama at Yale University, where she earned a Master's of Fine Arts degree in 1975. She then moved to New York to begin a professional career as an actress, and she would be an acting force in the 80s and beyond, with films like Sophie's Choice, Silkwood, and Out of Africa.
Lord Delamere, may I present Baroness Blixen. Baroness Blixen, Lord Delamere, such as he is.
Lord Delamere.
Baroness, a Swede, are you?
No, Danish, actually.
Ah, the little country next to Germany. If it comes to war, where will Denmark stand?
On its own, I hope. We do have that history.
Is there something we can call you that gets around this baroness?
What do they call you, Lord Delamere?
D, if I'm lucky.
After the 1980s, she would only continue to have major success with films like The Devil Wears Prada. She would often fight the fight for equality and gender norms, once saying, "There's another specific challenge facing women and girls right now. We're viewed as equals, but we're still not there yet. For the first time, we have the expectation that we can have a broad array of choices, that we could lead in almost any part of society, and yet we still face resistance. We see that here in our home, in our government, in the House, and the Senate. We see that in our boardrooms. We see that in Hollywood." She goes on to say that the challenge for our girls is dealing with the resistance. How can we lift and defuse it? How do we make it so our equality is not so threatening? Our girls are going to have to contend with that. I contend with it right now in every realm I operate in. And Meryl Streep won the Cecil B. DeMille Award for Lifetime Achievement in Acting at the Golden Globes. But it was her acceptance speech that's still blowing people away.
They gave me 3 seconds to say this, so. An actor's only job is to enter the lives of people who are different from us and let you feel what that feels like. And there were many, many, many powerful performances this year that did exactly that. Breathtaking, compassionate work. But there was one performance this year that stunned me. It sank its hooks in my heart. Not because it was good. There was nothing good about it. But it was effective and it did its job. It made its intended audience laugh and show their teeth. It was that moment when the person asking to sit in the most respected seat in our country imitated a disabled reporter, someone he outranked in privilege, power, and the capacity to fight back. It kind of broke my heart when I saw it, and I still can't get it out of my head because it wasn't in a movie. It was real life. And this instinct to humiliate when it's modeled by someone in the public platform, by someone powerful, it filters down into everybody's life because it kind of gives permission for other people to do the same thing. Disrespect invites disrespect. Violence incites violence. When the powerful use their position to bully others, we all lose. Okay, go up with that thing. Okay, this brings me to the press. We need the principled press to hold power to account, to call them on the carpet for every outrage. That's why our founders enshrined the press and its freedoms in our Constitution. So I only ask the famously well-heeled Hollywood foreign press and all of us in our community to join me in supporting the committee to protect journalists, because we're going to need them going forward, and they'll need us to safeguard the truth.
And of course, Meryl is just a phenomenal, phenomenal actor. Well, that is our list. Who do you think is a total badass? Let me know. I appreciate you. You are awesome. And as always, friends, have a wonderful, wonderful day. Subscribe to Retro Renaissance Channel.